Hi, I'm Norman Wildberger. Today, let's talk about how to learn mathematics. I'll throw a few ideas towards you. The main one is that mathematics is like a landscape. And becoming familiar with mathematics is a lot like becoming familiar with a landscape. Or if you prefer, a cityscape. Mathematics is a very rich discipline. There's a lot in it, even in any one given subject, like geometry. There's a lot of patterns, there are a lot of different objects, there are many intricate relationships between things. And learning about the subject really involves getting in there and becoming familiar with a lot of these patterns and relationships. If you move to a new city or a new town, and you want to quickly familiarize yourself with it, what would you do? Well, first of all, you probably study a map. The analog of that in mathematics is to study a book. A map or a book has a lot of theoretical information that encodes the landscape or the subject. But that's not enough. You'd probably also take a tour. If you were in a new city, say New York City, take a tour. Somebody points out there's Central Park, there's Grand Central Station, there's Saks Fifth Avenue, and so on. A highlight of the major points according to the person who's giving the tour. That's a very good way of structuring and getting some initial contact with the landscape. In mathematics, the analogous thing is to take a course where someone presents their view of what's important. But both of those have a little bit of a passive nature. When learning mathematics, it's important to move from passive to active. Same as when you were trying to learn or become familiar with a landscape. And the way to do that is to explore it on your own. In the case of a cityscape, Manhattan, walk around. Spend days and days walking around, driving around. That's the way you become familiar with things. So the theoretical understanding is balanced with a practical familiarity. In mathematics, we also want to do that. That's the third important aspect of learning mathematics, is to explore it on your own. Continuous application, perseverance, determination are all key in order to make these three things happen, especially this third one. In my view, a mathematics book should be concise, precise, and complete. It should serve as a reference in later years. There should be lots of pictures and diagrams, because people can learn things more easily if it's presented in a visual way. The layout should be pleasant and easy to read. We should avoid pages and pages of uniform writing. Should be spaces and headings. Very important, there must be lots of examples and exercises. This is to help students become more active. By giving them examples to work through, and especially exercises to do, they can start learning this material on their own, bringing it into themselves. And of course, a book must relay the author's understanding, because the author is supposedly an expert. A course in mathematics must be pitched at the right level for the intended audience. There must be a more emphasis on important topics. Unlike a book, a course is more selective, so it must focus on things a little bit more selectively and rely on the book often to fill in some details. It's a more personal approach to learning because it's being presented by someone directly. But there still must be lots of examples and exercises in a course, because that's the way we move from passive to active. So if you're trying to learn mathematics, the things to do are relatively simple. You should read the book. You should attend the course. And you should try to play as active a role as possible. That means, first of all, to take notes. Taking notes is a very good way of transferring visual and audio information also into tactile information, because you're actually writing it down. And if it's in your own hand, then that's a good way of solidifying it for you. Of course, you must study the examples carefully, and you must do lots of exercises. And what about exploring on your own? Well, we can try to verify theorems by studying special cases and finding new examples. You could make connections. You could ask questions and try to answer them. And you can look for computations that you can make. So how does this apply to this course in Rational Trigonometry and Geometry? Well, it's still, I think, important for you to take notes. It's very valuable, but looking at these videos, to watch them and write down in some notebook a consistent summary of each video. Secondly, make sure you study the examples carefully. Copy them down. Work through them yourselves. Figure out variants that you can also work on. Geometry is full of rich things. It's very easy to come up with examples that you can study. Because we're working in the grid plane often, it's easy to conjure up points, lines, triangles, circles, whatever. And study them, calculate, compute, check out that the theorems really do work. Next time, we're going to start thinking about special relativity and the geometry associated to it, which is going to be a whole new world of geometry for us, and in which rational trigonometry plays a key organizing role. It's going to be very interesting and exciting. I hope you'll join me for that. I'm Norman Wildberger. Thanks for listening.